Hello, and welcome to The Knit Girls. This is episode 460. We're out of the 50s.
We are, finally.
Felt like we're in the 50s for forever. I'm Laura, also known as Lala.
I'm Leslie, also known as You Don't Call Me Les. Today is Tuesday, October the 29th.
Almost Halloween, y'all.
2019. Yep, it is almost Halloween. I have a 16-year-old kid who will not be trick-or-treating.
Well, he hasn't for that's the past a little, couple yeah, years. I was going to say, that's a bit old. There's a trunk-or-treat going on at the college by my house.
Yeah, he would have to leave the house for that.
So. He could almost drive himself.
I feel like that's not going to happen.
They had food trucks. I was like, oh, if only I had not eaten. But, anyway.
I don't think anything interesting, like...
I have game duty on Halloween.
Oh, do you?
In the rain.
Is it
40-degree rain?
Football?
Yeah.
Oh.
We're in the championships, yo.
Whoa.
For middle school, 8th grade A team. So I've been promised that it will last no longer than an hour. And that I should wear weather-appropriate gear. So I'm probably going to go buy some hand warmers if I can find them.
Yeah, usually 40 you can degrees get them at, like, Walgreens or something.
Yeah, I don't know if it's... It seems like very early in the season, though, to find
them. That's true.
We'll see. I'm also taking kids on a field trip to the zoo on Friday when it's going to be a high of 50.
Yeah, but you'll be moving around, so I expect you won't get too chilly then.
I hope not. We'll see.
Yeah. Okay. Well, this is actually a knitting show. Would you like to talk about your knitting?
Sure. I am knitting on a sock. It is out of Joanna Knitspin Farm. In her unusual holidays series, she has a sock club, and this is the second sock. I'll pull out the first in a second. So I just turned the heel at work today, and I am zipping around. I have the book fair at work, so when the kids come in just to browse, like, even if they don't have money, they can come in and browse. Mm-hmm. They browse for, like, I put on Michael Jackson's greatest hits in the length of one song, which is usually around 5 minutes. And they can just browse, and then if they want to actually purchase stuff, they can come back, bring money another time, and come back. So it's just them looking through.
Yeah.
I wish it could be for longer, but then they wouldn't be able to check out books, because I only see them for 45 minutes. So while they're browsing, I don't, like, stalk them. I let them do their own thing. And I just, if they have questions, I answer. So I sit there and knit on a sock, because I can knit and not look,
yeah. Which
you guys probably have realized. I'm using Wendy Johnson's Toe Up with a Gusset from her first book. I think it's also available for free on her website, which is wendyknits.net. And I have 3 repeats to go, and this will be done. So hopefully it'll get done this month. Here is what I have left.
Is this for points?
Yeah, everything's for points.
I forget that sometimes.
You forget that everything's for points? I don't know how you could forget
that. So, what Laura's talking about is the Harry Potter Knit and Crochet House Cup, which is a group on Ravelry.com.
Yeah.
And there, it's a Harry Potter-themed sort of way to motivate you to get things done.
Yeah. So, that's pretty accurate. And here's the first one. And actually, they changed the rules this term where single socks would count as FOs. Mm-hmm. So, really, I'm finished with one class, but I'm going to try to finish
the other one. You get more points if it's 2, right?
You get more points the more yardage you use.
Yeah.
There's a magical formula that no one knows but the people on staff. So, yeah. And this is a Targi Sport, and it's nice and springy, mm-hmm. and I'm knitting it on size 1 needles. So, I'm digging how dense it is. I just bought some of the Addy Squared, my next month sock is also going to be out of this yarn.
Yeah.
So I think it might be for... These are for my brother-in-law for Christmas. That's why they're so big. I think it might be for my mom for Christmas. So I'll have to pick out the perfect colorway. But yeah, and I just have this much left. So size men's, like, 9.5 foot size. Like a woman's 11.5 out of 1 skein. With a substantial cuff, it's like a 5
I thought it was the other way. I thought, like, if it was a woman's 10, it was a men's, like, 11.
No. If it's a woman's, like, 10, it's a men's, like, 8.5.
Why?
I don't know. That's just how it is.
I'm gonna look that up. Because I'm curious. I could swear it was the other way.
And that's living in a suburban Stitcher Halloween bag. And then other things that I have on the needles. Another Halloween bag, shockingly. It's my favorite holiday. I got this from last year. Oh, that yarn shop in Simply Sock Company had a Halloween kit with Vesper, I think. So I picked it up. So, oh, I lost my needles. Hold on. I just need one.
Yeah, this is I-cord. At least in the U.S., like a women's 10 is a men's 8. It has to do with the width of the shoe and something about the incidence of the quad muscle relative to the kneecap. At least it's a somewhat scientific reason.
Okay. So I am knitting a flow bonnet. I'm knitting the ties, the little I-cord ties right now.
And this is a flow bonnet?
Yes. Hmm. I've knit it a couple times in the past.
Oh, okay.
It's just a garter stitch bonnet with a 3-needle bind off. So it's just you cast on a certain number of stitches. You knit for like 5.5 inches for the newborn size. And then you do the cord. And then you pick up and it goes around. So you're adding it as it goes around. And then you do the other cord down. So it creates a nice I-cord edge that goes around. And you do some like short rowing right here. So it like puckers it in the back a little bit. Like that. So yeah. Also Pearl's hair is everywhere. And this is going to be for the Hearts and Hands layout projects. And the yarn that I'm using for this is Judgy Rabbit. Was our SSK colorway this year. So it's got a bright yellow, a lighter gold, a bright purple, a navy, and like a teal blue. And so this is going to be the newborn size. And it's being knit on size 6 needles. And it's Teeny Button Studios, the person who dyed the yarn for us this year. And since I have like 7 skeins still in my garage, I decided to work on using one up. So I'm going to do this and probably matching Milo vest. So that's the first baby object on the needles. And because I wasn't feeling I-cord and one of my coworkers asked me to make, she just had her first grandchild. She didn't actually have it, but... Someone else.
That would have been weird.
Gave her.
I mean, I'm sure it's happened. Like mother's.
A grandchild.
Like surrogate for a daughter. I'm sure that's happened before.
Or a son, yeah.
Or
maybe.
A son, yeah.
So she asked me to knit him a baby blanket. And I was like, okay. And he's already been born. And I was like, can I do some smaller stuff instead? So I cast on just a simple baby hat using the Susan B. Anderson baby hat pattern 2 from her Itty Bitty Hats book. And I'm knitting it out of some hand spun. That's super wash that I spun ages ago and then plied over the summer. This is a little bit chunkier than what I normally spin. And that's also being knit on size 6 needles. That's why they're sharing a bag. So that I can share the double points. And those are 12-inch size 6 needles, which is my favorite way to knit baby hats, is on, like, 12-inch. And then the last thing that I have...
You got a lot on the needles right now.
Fair amount. This has been on the needles for, like, 2 weeks, but, y'all, I kept leaving it at home. I kept forgetting it. And it's not very far along. But this is the Hohe Locatelli,
Spectrum
shawl using some hand spun. So one of the hand spuns is some unknown hello yarn. It's around 500 yards. It looks like that. My winding on this was not the best, shockingly. And then the other is some Bumblebee Acres Cormo.
But you got it SSK this year and spun.
Yes, I did. And I'm hoping I have enough. If not, they sent me another 2 ounces to spin. So yeah, I just got started on section 2 of this.
And this is for your owl, right?
Yeah. And I still have to take pictures of the first half of my owl. So what it does is it starts with the dark, and then it slowly stripes into ending with the lighter color. And it actually uses more of the lighter color than it does of the dark color. It's a total of around 600 yards shawl. So I probably have like 25 yards in there.
Yeah.
But I'll get there. This will pick up starting next week. I'm really going to start moving on it. And I'll probably go to, I'll be in Baltimore the Wednesday, like a week before Thanksgiving. I go on the Wednesday. I'm gone Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
What will I do without you?
Hang out with Pearl. Because you told me you would. That you would leave in my house. And then I'll be back.
I'll just start going through all your stuff.
Okay.
I'll rearrange things.
You and Mama Linneman could create a conspiracy. If only she wasn't going to be in Philadelphia. Yeah, I'll be at the National Teachers of English Convention in Baltimore. If you are also going, let me know, and we'll meet up. We'll wait in line to get books signed together or something. But yeah, that'll be super fun. And George Takei is doing the keynote.
Yeah, you told me. That's
so exciting. I'm excited because he has a new graphic novel about Japanese internment camps. So I'm excited to see him speak live. Like, that's going to be pretty cool. LeVar Burton was there a couple years ago, and that was pretty cool. And they've had, like, Mo Willems. Oh, that might have been... That was ILA. They all blur together. But yeah, I'll be there in Baltimore. I'm excited. I'm going to try to go to Neighborhood Fiber Company.
You should go to Clover Hill as well.
Well, Clover Hill... Like, Neighborhood Fiber Company, I can take mass transit to.
Mm, yeah, Clover Hill's a little out of the way.
Yeah, it is. But, and I don't know how much time I'm going to have.
Yeah, for
like,
sure.
Like, one of my coworkers told me she'd go, she doesn't knit or anything. She receives hand knits quite a bit. She's very knit worthy. And I told her I really wanted to go to Neighborhood, but I didn't really want to go on my own in an Uber. Although I think I can take mass transit, like, from reading their website, I can. And she was like, I'll go with you. Because you hear all these horror stories now of women alone in Ubers. So... not, like, something that I want to happen. But she told me she would come with me if we took an Uber anyway. So that's exciting. So those are the 4 things that I have on my needles. That is a lot for me, but 2 of which are baby things. Like, everything will be off the needles by Friday.
It's just a lot of, like, relatively new all at once for you. Just because we hadn't seen the shawl before.
Oh, okay.
And then the baby hat.
I was going to say, none of it is really new. The baby hat is... and flow is.
The 2 hats, yeah.
Yeah.
So, not a criticism. You knit whatever the hell you want, whenever you want.
Thanks.
You're a grown-up.
I am. At least I play one on TV. Other people's TVs.
On the internet.
On the internet. Which you can stream on a TV. Yeah, that's it for me. I have no finished objects.
Okay. Well, I don't either, but I have a little bit of knitting and crochet to talk about. So... I haven't done a ton of knitting this week. To be fair, we recorded our last podcast like 5 days ago. So there hasn't been a ton of time, but, I'm still crocheting squares out of some 100% acrylic, impeccable. It's the base name yarn that I got from Michaels. I'm making a giant granny square patch, or giant granny patch blanket from Cherry Heart, also known as Sandra Paul. I finished one that I started as we started recording. So they take about 10 minutes. And I think I've got about 10 of them so far out of this color. Nothing super exciting. It's just a 3-round granny square. That I fill the time with as I have it. Sometimes I can knit for a little bit during work if I'm on, you know, certain meetings where I need to pay attention, but I don't necessarily need to participate a lot. But there hasn't been a lot of time for that this past week. So that's part of why I don't have a ton of crafting. The other thing I've been working on, which I have put a fair amount of time into, but it is every row is a lace row pattern. So it's not going as quickly as I would love for it to go. This is by Sari Nordlund, and it's a top-down lace pullover called Poet. It is knit out of a woolen spun fingering weight yarn. I believe it calls for Tuku wool, T-U-K-U wool, which is a Finnish wool. I'm using a different wool called Biche Bouche, which I believe is French. And it is also a woolen spun.
I have two extra stitches on one side of my sock. Like, half the entire time I've been knitting it.
Not surprised face.
Like, the entire time.
So how many stitches should you have, and how many do you
28
have?
28 on each side.
So you got 28 on one and 30 on another?
Yeah.
I'll just say ride it out.
I mean, there is no other choice at this point. It'll be alright. I'm sure my brother-in-law has one side of a sock. One side of a foot that's bigger than the other.
I mean, one of your feet is bigger than the other for almost every single person.
It'll be alright.
So
I just need to make sure that I'm making the length correct, because that'll eat in.
Yeah, that's true, to the yardage. And you already were going to be really tight.
Yeah, that's exciting.
She's like, don't remind me.
Super excited right now.
So I'm alternating skeins because it is hand-dyed, and the wool, it does, you know, it's not perfectly uniform, because it's not. So it starts at the back of the neck, and you do the back, and then you do the front, and then you join under the arms, and then it's in the round. But until then, it's back and forth, and the purl rows are not rest rows. So you have lace on both sides. So I've got sleeves, which are stockinette, and the front part, which right now is still stockinette.
Do you need a hand?
So this is what it looks like right now. I'm about...
It's pretty.
20 some odd rows in. It is pretty. I really am loving how it's looking, but it's just not brainless. It does require a little bit of thought. I did send it to my husband to blow up the chart, because the charts were tiny. The digital files aren't so bad, because you can manipulate them, but the charts in the book, because it was originally published in Lane, were not easy to use. So I blew it up, and so now I've got, the chart is only one page, which is great for the size. Excuse me, but I blew it up onto four pages total, and then just taped them all together, kind of like how you would do a sewing pattern. I just sort of taped them all together, so it's easier for me to read the stitches. I have a friend who's doing this with me, Ashley, and she's using Knit Companion.
Oh.
That was the app I couldn't remember the name of. And so, like, if there's a group of plain knit stitches in between pattern stitches, it'll tell you, okay, this group is four, or this group is seven, or whatever.
I've never used Knit Companion.
I used it when I still had my Android tablet, but it's not transferable between, like, you can buy it again for on an Apple device.
Uh-huh.
But I don't have an Android device anymore, so I don't know. I might consider it at some point, but this is actually, I don't want to say memorizable, because that's not necessarily true, but you get into a rhythm and you can kind of figure out where you're going. So it's not terribly complicated. I really like this a lot, so I hope that it turns out well. I'm always wary. I will come back and do a little bit of ribbing at the top afterwards, because this pattern isn't completely flat. It's got, like, dips and, like, peaks and valleys, so to speak.
Yeah.
Because of the nature of the lace pattern. So the ribbing will help smooth that out to some degree.
Yeah. You can also do short rows in those ribbing.
Yeah, but it doesn't bother me. Okay. It doesn't bother me that much. I just wouldn't want it to curl in on itself. But yeah, I really like it. I like using the wool. It hasn't broken on me or anything, but I have been making an effort to not be super rough with it because it is a woolen spun, so it's not going to be as strong as a worsted spun. But I haven't had any problem with it so far, so I really like it a lot.
It's really pretty. I think it's going to be nice and lightweight.
Yeah, I'm hoping. But anyway, that is all of the crafting that I can think of that I have done in the past week. I did spend a little bit at Laura's house.
She stole some fiber from me.
Yeah, because I took this over to knit on and didn't bring anything else. And we were watching some Drag Race
UK.
And I already struggle with some of the stronger, like, Irish and Scottish accents. And so we have subtitles on, which is great. But I can't read subtitles and read lace at the same time. So I was like, just whatever you don't want to spend, just give me something. So I stole something of hers, and I'm spending it on the...
Blackbird.
Yeah, the Blackbird over there. So
yeah.
So that's it for me for what I'm knitting. But you have a ton of spinning, right?
I have three things. I still have one thing to ply.
Okay.
So I applied my detention project for this month, which was some Cormo alpaca from Spotted Circus Alpacas. I really like the end product. I wasn't really, like, I've never spun alpaca before, so it wasn't, like, my favorite thing to spin ever.
I'm very excited to see this, because I have some, too.
Yeah, you do, because we split. So Elizabeth sells it in 6-ounce bags, so Leslie and I split it. It's still a little damp. So this is Cormo and alpaca.
Is it 50-50? I can't remember.
I think it's 50-50. It was a little, I felt like the alpaca was a little slick to spin. I did add a little bit more twist than I normally would, mm-hmm. and it came out definitely when I washed it. I feel like it's pretty... Yeah.
You've got like a couple of tiny little curly cues, but yeah. Other than that, it looks pretty balanced.
And I think part of that is from using the match. No, I used the ladybug on this. Never mind. I can't even use that as an excuse. Those will just knit out.
Oh, yeah, for
sure. It did have some veg matter in it, but the end result is like super soft and drapey. I'll combine it with something else. I think this is...
you got good yardage.
352 yards out of 3 ounces. I spun it worsted, not woolen. I thought about doing woolen, but there was quite a bit of veg matter in it, so I was picking it out as I went. Which veg matter doesn't bother me. It tells me that it came from a farm.
Yeah.
But yeah. It's got some uneven spots in it. It was a struggle a little bit for me to get it even. But I get more perfection-y, I think, the longer I spin. So yeah, I'm quite happy with it. I think it's going to... Actually, you know what would be great is like a sock head hat.
Yes.
It might be a little bit thinner. It's more of a lace weight, I think, than a fingering weight.
It would be a good drapey, like, so...
Or a cowl.
I've been wearing hats to bed for the past week or two, both because it's been cool enough to do so, and it gives me an excuse to wear a hat. Because we don't get a ton of those here. But also, because I am a very active sleeper, I flip-flop around a lot. And so, like, the hair on the side of my head gets really frizzy and, like, agitated. But if you wear a hat, it protects it from that. Hmm. Like, I know a lot of people will wear a sleep bonnet or some version of that. But, yeah, like, a nice drapey hat would be good to wear to bed.
Yeah.
Or to
I wear out. A sock head to bed a lot of times if it's cool enough. I still haven't turned on the heat in my house, but that might change November 1st because the high at the end of this week is going to be in like the 40s. So we'll see. But yeah, I'm super happy with that. I have all the tags in there and I just haven't tagged stuff. I brought them with me. They're at the bottom of my thing, I think. Oh no, I put them in the secret pocket. So, yeah, alpaca Cormo, spun on the ladybug, plied on the mini spinner, just because the mini spinner, I have a woolly winder on. I would have a woolly winder for all my wheels if I could.
For plying, not for spinning, necessarily.
Yeah, probably more for plying. Although sometimes for spinning. It depends on how I'm spinning. Like, I wouldn't use it for long draw.
Yeah.
but maybe some other things. I take that back. I would like a Woolly Winder for all of my castle style wheels, not my large
Saxony
style wheels. All right. So now that's labeled too. Yes. Getting some work done as I talk to y'all. And this is like a light gray with some pops of dark gray, and there's like a slimer green that appears every like once in a while. Yeah. I love it. Really, really pretty. Elizabeth just got back from SAF, so she's filling her shop as we speak. And then when we went to Lady Men Fiber Arts, I won some needles, but there were people who won door prizes that were not spinners, so I offered to exchange the needles that I won for, because I have lots of needles, and actually had some of these needles. They were the
hexagonal.
Yeah, there we go.
Indian Lake Artisan?
Yeah. And I already had a set, so I already knew how they worked. But someone had won this goodie bag from Euphoric Fibers that didn't spin. So we traded. So this was a giant bat that was in there. It was all mixed fibers. It's got some glitter in it. And I spun it worsted on the matchless. And my matchless is set up in double drive, which is a different way of pulling the fiber in and adding twist. It's a tension system. And this is a 3-ply. It was plied on the mini spinner, and it's 192 yards.
That would make good, like, pumpkin hats.
I said woolen spun, right? Yeah, it's woolen spun. Sorry if I said worsted spun. So I was, like, pulling back and letting the twist. I spun it long draw. Yeah, I think it will. The only problem is it's not going to be super wash.
Yeah.
That and I don't know what's in it, so yeah. If a child has any allergies.
Yeah, that's true.
But it might be a perfect pumpkin hat for me. Maybe I need a pumpkin hat.
It's always possible.
Could be. But yeah, it's a nice bright orange bat for sure. So that is done. I love the glitter. And it's got like undertones of yellow that were in the bat. Like a more reddy orange. And then an orange. Yeah, that might make a good pumpkin hat for the woman who I'm knitting the baby hat for. Maybe I'll knit a pumpkin hat real fast. Real fast. She has her grandbaby this weekend.
Do you want to know what your mom's doing right now?
Yes.
She's making me sourdough English muffins.
Of course she is.
Because every time I...
When is she going to give them to you?
Probably at Christmas when you come. But
I was trying to convince her to come for a visit.
Every time I eat the sourdough, I've got two individual ones left. And every time I eat one, I send her a picture and I'm like, these are so delicious. Thank you. Hint, 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 hint.
She does make them. This is still a little bit wet. It turned my water bright purple. Like I threw it in its bath this morning and left for work and the water was bright purple. So now I know next time I'll add some citric acid, but it didn't disturb the colors. This is, again, Euphoric Fibers. This was 2 ounces, and it's a 50-50 yak merino blend. I have never spun yak before. I started trying to long draw it, and I didn't like how it was coming out. And I did want to mention, so the Spotted Circus alpaca is true roving. It's not top. That was something that I wanted to mention as well. And this, I think, was roving... No, this was top. So a little bit more aligned, whereas the Cormo alpaca blend was not.
And that's all about the prep of the fiber itself.
Yeah. So I spun this worsted. I spun this on the matchless. Again, that's set up in double drive. And plied it on the Hansen, which is set up in Scotch tension, because that's the only thing Hansens do. And yeah, I'm happy with it. It's got a nice sheen to it.
It does. Ooh, that's actually got a really good color accuracy right now.
Yeah, it's like purple, like a wine color with like a blue. It's very jewel tones. It's not very me. I think this is going to go in a gift bin.
Really?
Yeah.
That's not very you? There's so much reddy purple in that.
It's more red than purple, but yeah. I don't know.
Surprising.
It's not gray.
It's very pretty.
Thank you. It's very soft, extremely soft. I'll try spinning yak again. The fiber was very well prepared, for sure. And then there was a third thing in the goodie bag, but Mama Lineman had gone through the goodie bag. And I don't particularly, if you've just tuned into the show for the first time, I hate silk.
She does not enjoy spinning silk, or tinsel, or bamboo, those types of things.
It is my least favorite thing. It's too, anything that gets slick is not my favorite. So I...
Which is so weird to me, because she spins so thin when she wants
to. Well,
and
that's the other thing, like, I will spin a silk blend, like a 50-50. I can get up to 1,200 yards out of 4 ounces, and that's too thin. I don't knit with that.
It stops being fun at that point?
No, I just don't knit with that weight. Like,
yeah.
I can't tell you the last thing that I knit out. Well, I can tell you. The last thing that I knit out of lace weight was probably the Wendy Johnson.
I mean, you're currently sort of on the needles... Have some hand-spun lace.
I think it's more of a fingering weight. What does,
Even Star calls for lace weight.
Okay, maybe it is lace weight. Alright, so Even Star is the last lace project, but before that it was a Wendy Johnson big circular shawl. I just don't knit with lace very often. Although the lady who does the gnomes, Imagine Landscapes, mm-hmm. just put out a new pattern that uses lace that's really, really pretty. So, yeah, that'll probably go in my holiday gift bin.
I like her stuff. Her styling is always really good.
Imagine Landscapes? Yeah. She's a sweetheart. She also plays House Cup.
Oh, that's cool.
She might be a good... She started teaching recently. Hmm. FYI.
Good to know.
Yeah, I know. So those are the three things, and I still have one thing to chain ply, but I don't like chain plying on the Hanson, so I need to... do that. I started a giant mashup sweater spin, but it's the first bobbin's not even done, but you'll start to see that come through. I started talking about it on Instagram. Basically, I have a pound and a half of Rambouillet in different colors.
Well, in different color ways. They're all in the same general family of colors. Like, they're put together in different ways.
Yeah.
So they are different colorways, but they all sort of have similar colors.
And I'm going to giant mashup spin those. And I actually changed my mind on how I'm going to do it. So I'm going to do one bobbin. I have two bags that are the same colorway. Like, flat out. They were, they're all Hello Yarn, too. So that was, like, a club colorway. Called Rustling Scales. So I'm going to do 2 3-plies. One of the 3-plies is going to be Rustling Scales all the way through. And I divided the fiber in half. So it'll have like one full color repeat and then one full color repeat, like end to end. And then the second bobbin, I'm going to take half from one bag and half from another.
Oh, so it'll be like a slow fade together. Okay, yeah. Yeah. That's what I did with that, I did that when I still lived in New Jersey. It was for, Spinzella 1 year.
Yeah, you did that Spunky Eclectic mm-hmm. sweater out yeah. of it. That's a pretty sweater. So, I haven't seen that in a long time.
It goes to, SSK every year, and that's about it.
Is it just too warm for you?
Yeah, it's too warm.
Oh. It's a shame.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that calls for, like, a bulky spin almost.
Yeah. I enjoyed doing it. I enjoyed spinning it and knitting it.
I have no hand-spun sweaters. Out of my... Well, I have one that... Radiate has the yoke.
Yeah. That should be a 2020 goal.
Yeah, it was a 2019 goal. It didn't happen.
It's okay. It happens.
I did finish a sweater spin, so I finished, and I finished spinning an entire
That's
fleece.
That's right. That's right. That brown one.
So, the yarn's there. It just needs to be knit. But now we're getting into holiday knitting, which I'd love to get done by December 1st. But that's not going to happen. But these will be for my brother-in-law, and then I'll just have... My sister's socks are already done.
Yeah, you finished those earlier this year.
Yeah, or a couple of years ago, and they've just been waiting in the bin. I tend any socks that are too large for me go to my sister, so... I have a couple pairs in reserve for her. And then some other people to knit for. The nieces usually get hand-knit gifts. and Amy Florence is getting a hand knit gift. Spoiler. But yeah, that's basically it, I think. You're getting cooling seat warmers for your car. We already had this discussion.
Cooling seat warmers.
Yes. Yes. Cooling seat cushions for your car. Yeah, that's it for... I am still reading the same books. So, the high school librarian came down to visit because we're trying to set up a network where, at least the high school librarian and I, like, I'm teaching things that lead into her curriculum. And so we were planning a little bit and just discussing how we run our libraries. Because I've been in my library for 14 years now. And because I taught a year in DeSoto County before I moved to library. And this is her, she's been in library 1 year. And she has a master's in library science and I do not. So it's interesting to get different viewpoints. Mm-hmm. So she came down for a visit and she was saying like a lot of the high school librarians carve out, like they set aside some time, like 30 minutes a day to read so that they're getting their reading in so that they're able to recommend books to kids that come in.
Yeah.
And I just kind of like carve out time when I have it.
Yeah.
If I'm eating lunch and my friend who usually eats lunch with me eats, she's a sixth grade teacher. So if my lunch is during eighth grade that day, like I'll sit and read. As I eat lunch, if I'm not eating salad, salad's like hard to juggle a book and
yeah.
Today was a salad day, but I decided after I got done talking to her yesterday, visiting, that I was going to try to carve out 20 minutes every day, like not an extreme amount of time, because usually 20 minutes might be the only break that I get for the day. That might be my whole planning for the day, but like 20 minutes a day at work. And it might mean I have to stay after and just, you know, read for 20 minutes after. So today I didn't have a class coming in eighth period, which that's 42 minutes. I should have plenty of time to like read. No. I had a teacher who was like, hey, I have to go to the bathroom. Do you mind watching my class? Hey, can you do this for me? Can you do that? So I managed to get 15 minutes on Born a Crime Read, which is not bad. I'm in part three now, so I'm towards the end. I think there's four parts, maybe. I'm over the hump. I'm like 170 pages in.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping to finish that this week. And then next week we have, it's election day.
Yep.
In the States, November 5th. And we have an in-service day because they use the schools for polling in DeSoto County. So that's where you go and vote.
Oh, so Kobe won't be going to school.
So next Tuesday, Kobe doesn't have school. Teachers have school, but kids don't.
And next Tuesday is also Book of Mormon Day.
Oh, that's right. So that's exciting. So I am going to try to... It's also cheerleaders baby shower. Mm. One of my coworkers, who's the cheerleading sponsor, is having a little boy. And her baby shower is next Tuesday. So yeah, I'm going to try to listen to Dread Nation. I ran out of library time again. I'm terrible. So I might just borrow the book after I'm finished with Born a Crime. I might just borrow the book from my library and read it because I am enjoying it and I'm enjoying the narrator. I just don't have time. Like that when the high school librarian came and visited, she's like, you never sit still. Yeah. I was like, that is pretty accurate actually. I'm pretty much constantly moving. I get it, honestly, from my mom.
That's true.
But especially at work, like, I can't just sit and talk to someone. I'm like, I'm going to cover books as we talk, and then we can stop and take notes as needed, but...
Yeah.
Too much work to do to stop. But yeah. So I'm going to finish Born a Crime this week, and that's the Young Readers Edition, and then Dread Nation, and then I have, a bunch of you donated books to my library. Thank you so much. I wish I could show you the video, but I can't because it's got kids' faces in it.
I got to see it, and it was pretty damn adorable.
I had a bunch of them arrived Friday. I had around 30 boxes show up on Friday, and I had a class in there. And it just so happened that each of them got a package to open, And, see, I'm tearing up.
I love the little girl so with the hijab who was so excited.
Oh, yeah. So, it just happened that one of my students who wears a hijab opened a book, and there was a little girl, it's called Far From Home, I think is the name of the book, that she opened that box, and she's like, this is the first time I've seen a girl who looks like me.
Stop it, you're making me cry.
On the cover of a book, and like...
Yeah. It's a powerful thing.
Totally. Representation also really matters.
It's also very, sobering, thinking of the privilege.
Oh, yeah.
Of, you know, we as white women come from where that's a foreign concept to not...
Yeah. I mean, white characters still make up 50% of the books published for children in the United States. So, main white characters.
I would put that number higher.
Well, 25 is, like, animals.
Oh.
And then, the rest is made up by...
minorities and...
Well, different populations. Yeah. But, yeah. And then if you do own voices, it gets even smaller.
So that I don't know what that means. What does own voices
mean? Own voices means that I am from the culture that I'm writing about. Oh, okay.
All right.
It gets even smaller. So anyway, y'all make a difference. And, like, just being able to see yourself in a book in the library makes you feel welcome in that library. Which is why I'm so passionate about having inclusiveness in my library.
Okay. You have to stop talking.
I'm going to take a drink, because, yeah, I will totally, obviously, I will tear up, but the video is so, I mean, I wish I could show it to y'all. They were so happy. They were running around. Yeah. I was like, someone's going to get hurt.
Yeah.
But they made sure we had a box to collect all the notes, slips.
Yeah.
And there might be some that are still in books, and as I go through, but I am going to try, I sent a couple of thank yous out today. I'm just going to keep trying every day to send a thank you. Sometimes Amazon is weird, and you might get, like, 5 thank yous from me, because you sent 5 books, because you're 5 Five-tastic. Times amazing. So thank y'all so much. There's still lots of stuff on my wish list. And what goes on my wish list is books that the kids ask me for. Like, I had a kid today ask me for the last book in the Magisterium series by Holly Black, and we didn't have it. So I added that to there. Or there are new books that I see coming out that I see will be good for my students. So I think will be a good fit. Or there are books that if they're on there with multiple copies, they're books that I'm book talking. Or there are books that I have 50 kids on a wait list waiting for Fortnite books right now.
Yeah.
So, I actually went and bought, like, 10 Fortnite books the other day. I spent $100 on Fortnite books of my own money.
Yeah.
Because it's worth it. Like, anytime I see one of my kids, just their face lights up when I get them a book that they ask for.
Yeah.
Or it's purchased. They just get so excited. And they will come and ask me every day if their book's here yet. So, and I just don't have the budget to do that, to purchase books.
Personally or...
Period, yeah.
Professionally.
Yeah, that's true.
Because Mississippi is not super concerned about the education of its...
well, it's a money issue. Yeah. Everything comes down to a money issue.
That's true.
They're not willing to invest... The state is not willing to invest the money to pay teachers or to give money to education.
Yeah.
So. But that's why I'm in Mississippi. Like, I could go teach other places. That and you. I'd miss you if I moved away. It'd be very sad.
It would be sad because then you would have to have a house and a room for me and all my things.
I kind of already have room for you. you already steal all my things.
Other people use that room, but really.
I mean, it's a guest room.
But it's also Leslie's nap room on Saturday sometimes. It is.
That is a true story.
Last week we talked about a book that I read called, it's a 2-book series called Head On and Lock In. Lock In and Head On.
Oh, yeah, the narrator thing. I read that. You guys are so smart. So thank you for imparting that knowledge.
On YouTube, or I mentioned it on the podcast, and one of our lovely YouTube viewers said that it was done that way intentionally. It was read with both a male narrator and a female narrator.
The character was not given a gender.
Yeah, the character's name is Chris Shane, and the character's father is like an NBA star or former NBA star. And, but the character actually suffers from the disease of, that keeps him locked into his body. And
or her body.
Her body. Yeah, see, that's the, like, I'm such an internal misogynist, I don't even realize it, because I just, the name Chris Shane, I just assumed it was a man. I never noticed that at no point in either book was there a he or a she pronoun assigned to anything. I never even noticed it. So, A, that means it's a very well-written book.
Yeah.
Or books. But
series, yeah.
But also, you know, B, that's a great reason to do dual narrators for that kind of a series. So, I like John Scalzi in general. That's the author of those books. He writes a lot of other, like, sort of space opera, political war kind of funny sort of books. I'm not big on those, because a lot of it, if it comes down to, like, political maneuvering or battles, I don't care. Just tell me what happens at the end. I just don't care. So, anyway.
Which is hilarious, because you like Game of Thrones. And that's all those books are.
I like the show Game of Thrones. I cannot read George R.R. Martin's books. I do not enjoy his writing style. But, yeah, I'll watch the series. But I'm not, like, crazy obsessive about it like my husband was.
Did you see, it was interesting, it was making the Twitter retweets, I guess the guys who, maybe it was the writers or whoever did the first pilot episode, like, they just kind of threw it together. They didn't expect it to go anywhere. So it was just, like, thrown together last minute, like, no preparation. Like, not prepared at all. And then they have Game of Thrones, and it was just a commentary about how, like, some people can just throw stuff together, and other people could be the most prepared people in the world and wouldn't get the same opportunity.
And a lot of the time, it's just, like, what people want at that particular point in time. Like, you know, there are some books that I, you know, might have tried in my 20s and then just could not stand, but now love. I think it's just all about what you want and what you need.
I wish they would make Neil Gaiman's Graveyard book into a movie.
Meh, I didn't love that one.
Oh, I do. It's not the best first line ever.
Yes, I know. Something woke up and there's a knife in his hand.
No,
or something.
There was a hand in the darkness and it held a knife.
There you go. Anyway, so right now I'm listening to The Outsider by Stephen King. I just started a couple days ago. It's another really good one. I don't really know exactly what's happening yet. It starts with the brutal murder of a child, which isn't great. But they don't give you a ton of detail, which is good. But that's only the kickoff point for this weird series of events. And that's what it's mostly focused on, at least so far. I'm only about halfway through it. And then I decided to read the free sample of the 7th book in Dragonkin to see if it interested me enough. And it did. So I'm still reading Dragonkin, which is the G.A. Aiken series.
Yeah, I guess I didn't have that one. Is that what you were saying?
I don't know. I was reading it on mine. But it's called Light My Fire. It's the one with Selin, who was Izzy's original, like, lover. And he's with the... I forget the one, Elena something of the really long name of the Black Bear Riders of the Mountains of Misery of blah blah, blah. Like, she's got a really long name.
And she likes to use it to harass people.
Yes.
I was talking about that author's other series, the Honey Badger Aware series today, because we were talking about honey badgers, two of my coworkers and I was like, so I read this series with Aware honey badgers. I knew how honey badgers are jerks. Aware honey badgers are just as much jerks, and it's hilarious. And they were like, all right.
Whatever you say, crazy.
Yeah.
I do
like her other series, though.
So this is a male-female fantasy romance. Sort of, I guess. And The Outsiders is, like, contemporary horror. It may have... It's hinting towards a possibly paranormal thing, but it does... Nothing yet. I can't say for sure. Okay, so what else? Sorry, our notes are forever long today.
I know.
Also, so our show notes are always found on our website, which is TheKnitGirllls with 3 L's. .com.
We're still doing collections for Hearts and Hands Baby Layette. I need to go over to the post office box and see if anyone
has sent in donations. Yeah.
And I'm hoping that we'll be at Fiber in the Borough this weekend. I didn't realize it was this weekend. I thought it was the following weekend.
Yeah, I
for
don't
some
know.
Reason.
We'll have to
look and see what the weather is like and stuff before we commit to driving.
Because it's like 3 hours plus there, 3 hours plus back. So,
but we'd like to go to the local, that's about as local as we get shows, if we can. So if you see us there, please say hi. My library's Amazon wish list is linked below that.
This is for her school, not her personally.
Yeah, no. So that is linked down there, and it should send it right to my school. So you'll see that address on there too. We're going to do a separate episode of Stash Dash Favorites. We just have been lazy and not done it yet. So we'll get on that. We have the Halloween Craft All the Things that started back in September, and it's going until Friday. So you still have time to turn stuff in.
We have prizes for that, which we've talked about.
So we have donation prizes from Cattails, Miss Babs, Umbasito Fiber, Crafts Untold, Velvet Hippo Stitch Markers, and our friend Pam sent some stuff as well. And Velvet Hippo sent me another, she's going to send some more stuff as well. She has glow-in-the-dark stitch markers.
Ooh.
So I need to...
For all your knitting in the dark.
Yeah. For when you knit at the movie theater, I think that'd be super cool. It might be annoying to the people around you, but I think that'd be super duper cool. So I saw that on Ravelry. It came through on my email, but I just haven't been on Ravelry. And I need to respond to her. And I think that's it. Is there anything down below that?
So we did today open up vendor applications for SSK 2020. If you want to be notified of when the attendee lottery opens, which will also be the 5th next week, we're going to open it. It'll stay open for 2 weeks. We always leave it open for 2 weeks, so there's no rush. First come, first serve does not apply. It's a lottery system. It's the only way we can do it and be any kind of fair.
Yeah. And that allows people who don't have access during certain times to a computer, because I am one of those people, to still be able to throw their name in.
Yeah.
And then we'll draw probably the end of November, maybe. When's it open through?
Well, it's open the 5th, so we'll probably draw around Thanksgiving. Right before or during the week of Thanksgiving.
That sounds good, and then we'll notify y'all so you have plenty of time to know before the Christmas holidays or winter holidays, whatever you celebrate. I'm trying to think if there's... So SSK, just to backtrack, is the Super Summer Knit Together. It's a retreat that we hold in Nashville, Tennessee. We're still booking. We have one more teacher to book, so we don't have the cost and everything.
We always do a separate video for that.
And yeah, we'll do the video for that
next week at some point.
Probably next week.
Yeah. But yeah.
And lay out everything, and there'll also be information. You can see last year's information and what was included and how much everything cost on the SuperSummerKnitTogether.com website.
Mm-hmm. You can also pop into our Ravelry group, The Knit Girls with 3 L's, ask us any questions there.
Yeah, or the Super Summer Knit Together group. It's like Knit Girls Retreats group, I think is what it's called. Because we did do
SKP 1 year.
SKP 1 year.
Yeah. And in the future we may do something else, who knows. It's all depending on availability. I don't know why my dog is whining. My husband must have left for some reason.
To get food, maybe?
Who knows? Right. Sorry, do you not know that DoorDash exists? He will DoorDash McDonald's. And I'm aww, like, really? But only when I'm not eating here. Because I can't. I worked at McDonald's for a while. I can't eat it anymore. It's too... I just can't.
Anyway.
Yeah.
So I think that's it. Thank you guys so much. Thank you so much to all our Patreons and all of you for watching. We will see you next week.
Yep. Have a happy
in November.
Halloween.
Oh my goodness.
If you celebrate that. But otherwise, yeah, we'll see you next week.
Bye, y'all.
Bye, y'all.